Hi everyone, this video will discuss the qualitative analysis of anions, the experiment you will be performing this week. In the past 2 weeks, you have worked on the separation and identification of cations. This week, we will focus on anions. In one respect, this experiment is easier. For some anions, you will not need to separate them before you can identify them. This reduces the potential mistakes that can happen. For other anions though, you will still need to separate them out from others, but the steps are much simpler compared to the cation separation. Another difference is that in the anions test, you'll need to make two positive controls. One positive control will just be the anion of interest, while the other will be a diluted sample of the anion. The reason we do this is because your unknown sample will contain anions whose concentrations lie somewhere between these two positive controls. Knowing what the two extremes look like can prepare you for what to expect with the unknown sample. The way you make your controls are shown here, which is the same exactly as in your lab procedure. The last point I want to make is that in the procedures that I'm going to mention below, it always starts with mix 1 milliliter of your sample with dot dot dot. In the experiment, that 1 milliliter of sample could be your concentrated positive control, your diluted positive control, or your unknown sample. All right, let's get started with the actual procedures. Okay, the first test we're going to do is for the carbonate anion, and sodium carbonate is the positive control. Here you will mix 1 milliliter of your sample with 1 milliliter of HCl. You should start seeing small bubbles float to the top. This is carbon dioxide gas that's formed from the reaction between protons in your HCl and carbonate ion. This is just an acid-base reaction. A picture of this effervescence is shown here. The left one will be one for your diluted sample, and then the right one would be for your concentrated positive control. So in your unknown, if you don't see any effervescence, then no carbonate is present. Let's look at the next test, which is for the sulfate ion. In this case, we would use sodium sulfate as the positive control. You should mix your sample with HCl and then a few drops of barium chloride. If sulfate is present, a white precipitate, as shown in the picture, will appear. The HCl is just a catalyst that helps the reaction to occur. The actual reaction is just between barium and sulfate ions to produce barium sulfate solid. The third test is for the phosphate ion, which uses sodium hydrogen phosphate as the control. Here, you're going to add nitric acid to your sample, and then 1 milliliter of ammonium molybdate, and you would stir this mixture well to mix. You then want to heat the mixture in a water bath, which will help to form a yellow precipitate of ammonium phosphomolybdate if phosphate is originally present in the sample. The precipitate appearance is shown in this picture for reference. The reaction looks fairly complicated, as written here, but it really is just a precipitation reaction, which is catalyzed by acid. Okay, the next test is for the thiocyanate ion, which uses potassium thiocyanate as the control. Here, we will do a reaction you should be familiar with, the complex ion formation of iron thiocyanate, as shown here. You will add acetic acid to your sample, then 2 drops of iron nitrate. After stirring, you should see a red blood solution of the complex ion, which forms under acidic condition. Typically, you'll see the dark red solution as shown in this picture, or the slightly lighter one shown on the top right if your sample has thiocyanate. Now, there's a potential problem with this test, which is if phosphate is present. Recall that in the previous test, you already figure out whether phosphate is present or not in your unknown sample. So if phosphate is present, then when you add your iron nitrate, instead of getting a red blood solution, you're going to see a white precipitate instead. The precipitate is iron phosphate, and it will interfere with your detection of thiocyanate. So you'll have to remove all the phosphate first before you can test for thiocyanate. This is done by adding 2 drops of iron nitrate, mix to form the precipitate, and then centrifuging and discarding the pellet. To the supernatant, you will add 2 more drops of iron nitrate to see if more precipitate forms. If it does, then centrifuge again and remove the pellet. Collect the supernatant and just repeat this step until addition of your iron nitrate no longer produces a precipitate. At that point, check if the addition of iron gives you the blood red color. If it does, you have thiocyanate. If it doesn't, then you don't have it. Note that a very light reddish color doesn't mean that thiocyanate is present. That's just a contamination, and it's a very common false positive. Okay, so the next test is for the chloride ion using NaCl as your positive control. In this case, you will add nitric acid and silver nitrate to your sample, which will cause the formation of a white curdy precipitate of AgCl, shown here in this picture. The reaction is shown here. Now, if your unknown contains thiocyanate, then this test will actually give you a false positive, because silver and thiocyanate itself forms a white precipitate, which is the reaction shown here. So recall that the previous test we did was for thiocyanate, so you would have already known whether your unknown contains thiocyanate or not. So if you do have thiocyanate, then you have to remove it first before you can test for the presence of chloride. To remove the thiocyanate, you have to follow the steps below. So add 1 milliliter of your sample and 1 milliliter of nitric acid to a small beaker, and then you're going to heat the solution until the volume decreases by half. What the heating does is decompose all the thiocyanate ion, so you don't have to worry about it for your test. Once that happens, you can then transfer this solution back into a test tube and then add nitric acid with 3 drops of silver nitrate and stir and check if you see the precipitate. If that white curdy precipitate forms, then chloride is present in your sample. Okay, the last test here is for the nitrate ion, which uses sodium nitrate as the positive control. Here, you're going to add 1 milliliter of your sample
with sodium hydroxide
and a scoopula of aluminum powder or aluminum granules. And then what you're going to do is then put the test tube inside a water bath and heat it. While this mixture is heating in the water bath, you're going to get a red litmus paper and wet that litmus paper with water. When the mixture in the test tube is hot, you put the litmus paper over the mouth of the test tube. If nitrate is originally present in the sample, ammonia would be produced as a result of the reaction shown here. Since ammonia is a weak base and it is also a gas, it will evaporate to the top of the test tube and react with the wet litmus and change it to blue. Note that the litmus has to completely change to blue and not just showing small specks of blue. The specks are due to splashes of sodium hydroxide and it's a false positive. So you want to make sure that the whole litmus turns blue. If your unknown has thiocyanate in it, this test won't work. So you're going to have to remove the thiocyanate first. The removal occurs in 2 steps. First, you're going to add copper sulfate to precipitate the thiocyanate as copper thiocyanate, which has a black color precipitates as shown here. You then centrifuge to remove the pellet that contains the copper thiocyanate. Now, since you have excess copper in the solution, now you're going to have to remove the copper by adding sodium carbonate. The copper and the carbonate combine to form copper carbonate, which is a solid as shown here. You then centrifuge this test tube once more to remove the pellet. Now you can test the supernatant for nitrate ion. To test for nitrate ion, you're going to add a scoop of aluminum granules, heat the test tube, and then place the damp red litmus paper over the mouth of the test tube to detect the presence of ammonia. Again, if nitrate is originally present, then the litmus paper will turn blue. If nitrate is not there, then the red litmus paper will not turn blue. The last point I want to make is just about waste and safety. Just like the other 2 qualitative analysis labs, you're going to use your standard PPE for this experiment and discard all the waste in the chemical waste container.